I'm Bill McKibben, and this is The First Time. The first time that I really realized the significance of climate change wasn't when I wrote the first book about it 30 years ago. It's probably 15 years later. I was on a reporting trip in Bangladesh, which is, of all the countries in the world, one of the first to get really wrecked by climate change. The water is rising fast. But when I was there, they were having their first big outbreak of a disease called dengue fever that's spread by mosquitoes who are expanding their range rapidly as the planet warms. And lots of people were dying. I spent enough time in the slums that I eventually got bit by the wrong mosquito, and I got as sick as I've ever been. I didn't die because I was healthy and strong going in, but I remember looking at the people lying on the cots in these vast clinics and thinking, God damn, this is unfair. These people did nothing to cause this problem. When you measure how much carbon the country of Bangladesh emits, you can't even measure. It's like a rounding error in the calculations. And that really struck home to me that this was something that we had done, and we'd done it to everyone. I think that I fully grasped just how horrible the Trump years were going to be on day one, because the very first thing he did was sign a piece of paper saying, let's build the Keystone Pipeline and let's build the Dakota Access Pipeline. Take that, you indigenous people. Take that, you farmers and ranchers. Take that, you climate scientists. So far, we've managed to fight off the Keystone Pipeline. Who knows for how long we can do that, but we're sure going to try. And we lost the battle over the Dakota Access Pipeline, which just kills me because it's one of the most unjust things that ever got done. The first protest, really, I guess I organized was, or helped organize, because you almost never do it all by yourself, was in 2006. I came back from Bangladesh upset about what was happening and wanted to do something, but I live out in rural Vermont, what to do. So we organized a march. I just sent out a letter asking people to come walk across the western part of Vermont. And a surprising number of people responded. For 5 days, we walked until we got to our main city of Burlington. It's only 50,000 people, but it's what we got, okay? When we got there, there were 1,000 of us marching. And the story in the paper the next day said that 1,000 people in 2006 was probably the biggest demonstration against climate that had ever taken place in the United States. That's when I really knew that we had to go to work building movements big enough to matter. The first time I was arrested was outside the White House in 2011 at the beginning of the fight against the Keystone Pipeline. I'd written a letter asking people to come commit civil disobedience. We had no idea if anybody really would because it had been a long time since anyone had tried in the environmental movement. As it turned out, there were lots of people willing to go. Before the week was out, 1,250 people had been arrested, the biggest civil disobedience action about anything in a very long time in this country. And proof that this stuff works, because 10 years later, the Keystone Pipeline still isn't in the ground. I grew up believing that we had the best government that there was, and that faced with challenge, it would do the right thing. The first times I began to doubt that, I mean, there were obviously plenty of reasons to be wary in my childhood, the Vietnam War, Watergate, things like that. But the one that really hit home was in 1992, when the world was holding a big Earth Summit, the first Earth Summit in Rio de Janeiro. And on the way there, the President of the United States, George H.W. Bush, said to reporters, we'll go here and take part in this summit, but I want you to know that the American way of life is not up for negotiation. And when I heard him say that, I thought, we're not going to do a damn thing, are we? I remember just feeling like, how could these people be doing this? Don't they understand that, in fact, the American way of life and everybody else's way of life is not only up for negotiation, it's not going to last very much longer unless we get our act together. The first time I really focused on climate refugees and migration was watching what was going on in Syria when the epic drought 12, 15 years ago helped destabilize that country, pushing millions of refugees out into the world. And then we saw what that influx of refugees did to discombobulate the politics of all of Europe. Now we see the same thing happening on our southern border, where the drought in Honduras and Guatemala is sending people fleeing towards the U.S., and you see what it's doing to our politics, nothing good. I think that message has really struck home, and it's going to strike home for everybody, because instead of 1 million refugees at a time, the UN is estimating we may see 1 billion climate refugees before the century is out. The first time I heard about the Green New Deal was from the young people in the Sunrise Movement who thought it up. And I knew a bunch of them because they'd worked hard on the fossil fuel divestment campaigns on campus. And when they graduated, they wanted to keep this fight going. They formed this Sunrise Movement, and the Green New Deal was their brainchild. And the minute I heard it, I smiled, because that's the kind of scale of action we badly need. The first time I got really hopeful that we might be able to build a movement that would do something was when I met the 7 undergraduates at Middlebury College who went on to form 350.org. They're the most remarkable organizers I've ever seen, and they've gone on to recruit hundreds more just as remarkable as they are in every corner of the world. That's what gives me hope, people organizing.